Pleased to be joined right now, Bryan Neeman, by Dr. Emily Oster, economist at Brown University. And she most recently did a really, really intensive study looking at how we get back into schools. The piece she wrote in The Atlantic is Schools Aren't Super Spreaders. Good morning, Dr. Oster.
Good morning.
Thanks for having me.
Look, I want to begin looking at, when I say comprehensive, just how comprehensive this was. You got with a company called Qualtrics and took a look at 200,000 young people, students, in 47 states, which covered the last 2 weeks of September. What did you find and what did they find as it relates to the whole issue of COVID-19 in schools?
Yeah, so the sort of top line is that we're seeing in sort of infection rates over those 2 weeks would suggest in a school of 1,000 kids, you'd have about 1.5 infections on average over 2 weeks. So fairly low infection rates, much lower in elementary schools than in high schools. Staff rates are a little bit higher, but still something like 2.4 staff in a school among a group of 1,000 over 2 weeks. So that's kind of the biggest top line, at least from our early data here.
Can we compare it to anything else? Could we compare it to churches? Could we compare it to restaurants? Could we compare it to office space?
I think what you could compare it to is the community. You could say basically if you looked out at the case rates in the community and you said, are schools higher risk or lower risk? It looks like schools are a bit lower risk than the community overall, which is kind of the big focus here. I think some people come to school with COVID, but it doesn't look like COVID is spreading around the schools in a very aggressive way.
Schools aren't super spreaders. That is what's in The Atlantic. It's written by Dr. Emily Oster, an economist at Brown University. We're in a big debate here, Dr. Oster, as it relates to opening our schools. And many of the teachers' unions and teachers and really some of the elected officials are talking about it's not safe. They don't quantify what safe means. What would you say to them listening now? What would you say to them about schools being safe?
You know, I think there's sort of two pieces. One is one of the main things we see in our data is the kind of mitigation practices schools are taking. All the kids are wearing masks in almost all the schools we cover. There's some distancing. So I think there's an argument for really making sure that you have everyone in masks, that you can try to have some smaller group sizes. And that's kind of going to be one of the keys to a safe reopening. But I would also say on the flip side, you know, there's increasingly evidence that not opening schools is also really hard for kids and really damaging to health and to learning. And so I think we want to be careful to make sure that we're both opening in a way that is safe, but also thinking about what are the costs to not opening, that has risks too.
Well, if you could drill down on that, what are you seeing? What does the data show us about kids not being in school and what impact that is having on their learning, their behavior, their mental aspects?
So I think what we're seeing just in general in the population are really high rates of anxiety and depression and mental health issues. And when you talk to pediatricians about this, they're seeing a lot of that. We're seeing, you know, a lot of kids aren't logging on at all. So we're sort of kids who are supposed to be on online learning who we're not seeing at all in the data. A lot of school districts have been talking about that. And, you know, sort of finally, when we even look at some of the kind of learning data, like, say, from the spring, we saw huge reductions in learning, particularly among low-income students who maybe have less access to parents to sort of supervise their learning. So I think for all of those reasons, this kind of distance learning approach, it works for some kids, but it is clearly a struggle for many.
Dr. Emily Oster, you also highlight in the piece you wrote in The Atlantic, Alec McGillis, who we also had on our show here on the C4 and Bryan Neeman show, who wrote in The New Yorker about his relationship with a 13-year-old and what he experienced trying to mentor a 13-year-old. Just the nature also, Dr. Oster, of the achievement gap and the other things that we continue to hear about from an education standpoint, all of that exacerbates behind this, doesn't it?
I completely agree. I think, you know, we're already, our education system is fairly unequal to begin with. And now we're layering this on top of it. And we're seeing things where, you know, private schools are open and you know, public schools are not open. And, you know, that's kind of yet reinforcing these enormous achievement gaps and the kind of inequities that we're seeing. Alice's piece was, you know, great example of that. But I think it's not alone.
Yeah, it was heartbreaking to hear what he had.
It was hard. It made me cry.
Yeah.
Made me cry.
You mentioned that the rates are lower for elementary school when it comes to spread, which makes a lot of sense. We've seen that with the data. I'm curious, could you break it down into the different states, you know, like Florida, Texas, they've had higher rates than we have had. and yet we're not open and they are versus, you know, maybe South Dakota. Are the numbers the same, or does it depend on how widespread the coronavirus is in each individual district?
It depends on how on the community spread. So I think in our data, you know, we can break it down by, say, census division. So, you know, sort of areas of the country. And you certainly see the rates are a bit higher in places with more cases in general, and a bit lower in places with fewer cases. And again, I think that reflects the fact that, you know, when there is a lot of coronavirus in the community, then some people will come to school with the coronavirus. And of course, the job of the school is not so much to prevent people from arriving with COVID, but to prevent them from spreading it around. And I think that it is true that we're seeing the more, you know, COVID is in the community, the more you're going to get people at school, and the more important probably it will be to undertake some of these precautions to prevent spread.
Dr. Emily Oster wrote Schools Aren't Super Spreaders for The Atlantic. And, you know, one of the things not talked about a lot, we talk about the teachers, we talk about the students. We don't talk a lot about the parents and what they're going through. Bryan Neiman could appreciate appreciate this. You mentioned it in your piece that you wrote. I mean, this has really been since March. I mean, just a horror on parents, particularly working parents, Dr. Oster.
Yeah, I agree. And we're seeing that in, you know, labor force participation data. For example, we're seeing big drops in labor force participation for women, you know, leaving the labor force probably because they are needing to be home supervising kids. And that's just the economic cost. Forget about the sort of psychological costs. And, you know, I don't know if you guys have kids, but I find, you know, it's hard to be the sort of taskmaster teacher of my kids. I definitely appreciate their teachers much more, having tried to do this on my own.
Yeah. Well, I always say it's a lot harder to coach your own kid and teach your own kid. You know, somebody else's kid would listen to you more than your own kid would. So there's that aspect.
I hope so.
Yeah. I mean,
no prophet is harder than their own home. Just remember that.
So, you know, one of the things, a big concern here is that what's been going on in Maryland is that the teachers union has basically stopped the major school districts from opening, and teachers are concerned. And I get that aspect of it. Can you look at the numbers on how susceptible teachers are in the spread? If there is spread in the school, does it go kid to kid? Does it go kid to teacher? Do we have any data on that, doctor?
So I think the best data in our space that we have on that is we can look at what's happening with teachers in places where schools are remote. And so there are no kids, but the teachers are in the building, which is actually pretty common, versus places where the teachers are in the building with the kids. And actually, things look about the same. So if anything, maybe the rates are a bit higher when it's just the teachers in the building. So it sort of suggests that, you know, that there's something, either it's just coming in from the community at the same rate, or to the extent that it's spreading in the school, it's more staff to staff than student to staff. And so I think, you know, that reinforces how important it is, if you have teachers together, that they protect themselves when contacting other staff, other adults in the community, in the school community, in some ways more so than the kids.
You know, Dr. Emily Oster, you kind of reference it in what you wrote for The Atlantic, but we get the situation here in Maryland, Bryan and I talk about it, where zero is kind of the expected start to get kids back in school full time. And that's not realistic, is it, doctor?
No, I think it's not. I mean, I think the way I was talking about this is, you know, we open other things, water parks, you know, restaurants, all this kind of stuff, and we don't hold them to that standard. We say, you know, your job as the water park is to prevent people from getting COVID at the water park. But we're not going to say we have to wait till no one has COVID to open. And somehow with schools, we seem to be asking them to somehow like to prevent any COVID anywhere among people in their community, as opposed to saying, you know, your job is to prevent spread from within the schools. And I think it isn't realistic to say we have to wait till zero. And that's really, you know, that's going to fall on the backs of our kids. And that's going to be really bad for them.
If there is a breakout, what's the best policy to move forward? I mean, if one kid tests positive or two kids in a school test positive, should you shut down the entire school for a couple of days? Do we have a best practice for that?
So I'm not sure we have best practices. I think in some ways the best practice is to have a plan. And I think it's almost certainly not appropriate to close the school for a single case. If you start seeing that there's some spread that's clearly going on in the school, you know, you have 3-4 cases in the same group, then probably the school needs to close for a bit, step back, think about, okay, what are we doing that's not right? But, you know, schools need to be prepared for, like, what are they going to do when there's a case, in part because it's scary for people. And if you have a plan in place, then you can say, okay, you know, we had a plan, and here's what we're doing. We're, you know, doing this cleaning protocol. We're closing this one classroom. We're doing this. And then, you know, we're going to move forward. I think that's just really important for helping people not be afraid.
Dr. Emily Oster, what kind of reaction have you gotten? Because, I mean, you're talking about 200,000 young people over 47 states, and yet still you have this resistance and pushback. What have you heard back since you wrote this?
I mean, I think, you know, some people have written and said, like, yes, you know, we really need to get people back in schools. But certainly, you know, on the pushback side of this, I think that there are a lot of people who say, you know, until we're certain that everything is 100% safe, we can't go back. And, you know, I hear that, but I also think that really ignores some of the costs that we're paying to having schools closed. It's not the case that this has no downside. And so, unfortunately, I think we may need to be moving forward without being certain. That's really the biggest piece of pushback I've had.
Well, can I just add one more thing and let you go on this? And that I have had people say, well, you are not a medical doctor. You're an economist, an established, a respected economist at an Ivy League school, mind you. But aren't numbers numbers no matter what? I mean, don't we just look at data? Isn't that how we decide things? That doesn't have to be medically. I'll let you answer, but I mean, that's my view on it.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, the numbers are what they are, and my job is to do statistics and to collect data. And I think that, you know, certainly it would not be hard to find doctors, and I talked to many of them, who would have the same view. You know, the AAP has said that we should be back in school more. Anthony Fauci has said that we should be back in school more. But I think it really, I would have answered exactly the way you would, which is, you know, the data stands for itself, and whether my degree is in economics or in medicine, the data is what it is.
Well, it's great to have you on. Thank you so much for your time. We greatly appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, Dr. Emily Oster, economist at Brown University. You can read her piece in The Atlantic, which is entitled Schools Aren't Super Spreaders.
It's not just that she's an economist, Brian. You know, people want to put it on that, but the books that she has written, she's written a couple of books on parenting, on birth to preschool. So her focus, even though she's an economist, has been on early education and on, you know, the impact that has. So, you know, when I hear you stay in your field or stay in your lane, so to speak, I get upset because a lot of people who are in the lane aren't going by what the numbers are, whatever it is.
Right. I thought it was really interesting because, and this is something I've been saying for a long time, and I know I got a lot of criticism for it, but what she said about teachers, I had a medical doctor at one of the big hospitals tell me that he was more concerned about the employees at the hospital passing coronavirus on to each other, passing it when they're at breaks or when they're talking to each other, than he was with the patients. And that is the same thing. That is the same thing that what she is talking about with teachers. It's really, you know, they have to worry just as much, if not more so, about spreading it from teacher to teacher in their conferences and their meetings than they are when it comes to, you know, the kids.
Now, having said that, Brian, I will vociferously argue that they need to have the right PPE, you know, the right disposable materials and that type of thing, not using reusable things. So I think what is important is that we not say that teachers just get back into, just get them safe. But once we make sure the materials are there, Brian, let's get back to work.
All right.
Let's get back in there.
But Mr. Senator, I have a request for you.
Okay?
And a little request for you.
Uh-oh.
And that is, I need this interview to be included in the next Board of Education meeting in Baltimore County. So that they can all listen, the board members, the superintendent, the county executive, if he wants to listen, the teachers union, so they can hear exactly what Dr. Oster had to say in her data-driven analysis. Science, we're talking about, C4. If we could get that into the public record, that would be fantastic. And I'm happy to, you know, bring
would you a smile.
I'll put it on a cassette tape in my boombox and put it up there. I'll hold it up, right?
All right, John.
Just like say anything. I'll do that to get the kids back in the school building.